for now. You have the Gulf of Aden, and of course that is the Somalia. This now used to also be a hotbed of
it still is
a hotbed of pirates. Then you have the Gulf of Guinea, which is our own region. Now, but if you notice, in the past 12 months, there's been a significant drop in cases of piracy. And sometimes let's also distinguish between piracy and sea robbery. There's been a significant drop in the cases of piracy and sea robbery. What did we do to get this drop? Three important things that we have done. One is that we have built regional network with our colleagues in Ghana, in Togo, in Cameroon, in the entire Gulf of Guinea region. We have built a regional network, and so every single day we exchange information, and so we know what's going on. So if a vessel is attacked in Ghana, all our allies within the region are up. They are alerted immediately, and everybody. So the pirates now know that there is this regional network. Apart from building a regional network, we have also built local network, I mean national network, with the Navy, with all the intelligence agencies. And so our response capability has been enhanced. And so locally, if we have also built a surveillance system, what we call a maritime domain asset, whether with the Navy, it's called Falcon Eye, the MP has also built a surveillance system. We have a surveillance system, and we're making efforts to integrate all our surveillance system so that wherever you are within our maritime domain, we have a bird's eye view of what you're doing. And so when there's a suspicious movement, we're able to confront whatever that suspicious movement is. Mm-hmm. And that has truly stemmed this issue of piracy and sea robbery. Okay. But most importantly, a major accomplishment we've done is that we've got a presidential approval for what we call the Presidential Initiative on Maritime Security, where we will acquire some very important assets, deploy them at strategic locations so that we can respond to any case of distress or even prevent it. Our view is prevention, not to wait for any of those things to happen. We're putting in place a number of things.
Okay, let's talk about the cabotage law.
I was going to save that to the last one because I wanted to take him back. Okay, let's go there. Maybe we'll end up with the employment thing.
The cabotage law, how effective has it been? Is it achieving its goals?
It's been very effective. A few persons might disagree with us, but if you look at the statistics support the fact that it's been very effective. Pre-2003, when the Cabotage Act was passed, there were less than 12% Nigerians on board vessels plying our trade in Nigeria. Today, they're over 60%, indicator number one. Indicator number two, pre-2003, when the Cabotage Law was passed, there were less than 10% of vessels flagged Nigeria. Today, over 65% of vessels trading within our coastal waters are flagged Nigeria. Indicator number three. I can go on. Now, before now, there were no vessels, zero vessels built in Nigeria. Today, at least 10% of the vessels trading within our coastal waters are built in Nigeria. Are we satisfied with that? The answer is no. But we have challenges why those vessels are not built in Nigeria. Cost of finance is one. There are many other factors outside of our control. Cost of finance is one. The absence of our aluminium and steel industry is another challenge. Three, the lack of technical manpower to build vessels. Now, the lack of competitiveness of our manufacturing industry as a whole. Those are factors why we're not able to build ships. So there are four pillars of the cabotage law. And we've done well in three, in terms of flagging, in terms of manning, in terms of ownership. Mm-hmm. In ownership, we've done well, whether it's bareboat charter, outright acquisition. Now, one major challenge people have had to complain about with the cabotage law is the cabotage vessel financing fund, CVFF. How come from 2003 to today, that fund is actually a contributory fund? No fund has been disposed to support local players to build capacity to acquire more vessels. That's been the challenge, and we're addressing it.
Okay, but
where are these shipyards? I'm sorry, where are these shipyards in Nigeria?
Now, in Port Harcourt, there are two shipbuilding facilities in Port Harcourt. One is in Onne, actually. One is in Port Harcourt. There is a shipbuilding facility in Warri. Now, some may argue they build barges, they build tugboats, they've not built the real big vessels. Again, you grow capacity. Nobody starts one day by building the real big vessels. 120 metric ton tanker, 200 metric ton tankers. Nobody builds that overnight in our local industry. You grow capacity. You grow on at a regular basis. And we're growing. We're building.
The cabotage law, it's believed that Nigeria's cabotage law is the only one that has waivers. And those waivers are causing inefficiencies and discrepancies here and there. How do you react to that?
Absolutely not correct to say Nigerian cabotage law is the only one with waivers. Now, our cabotage law was modeled after the Jones Act. It was modeled after some similar other laws around the world. In all of them, and I challenge anybody, there are provisions for waiver. Even the Jones Act, where the United States coastal waters is bigger than even the coastal waters of some continents. And so they can trade in country without any form of support. But there are they still make provision. What the cabotage law says, we restrict foreigners. We're not saying foreigners should not come. Because it's not possible to grow this capacity overnight. The bigger picture for us is that over the next few years, we'll grow capacity in all areas to the extent of 100% so that we don't need these waivers. Have the issue of waiver, or has the issue of waiver been abused in the past? Most likely, but we're stemming, we're working on it.
Okay, let's put aside this mail. Come the tweet from Femo Diban says, we have many young people, men and women, who have qualified as seamen but are yet to be employed. Then why do we talk about shortage of manpower?
Now, you see, when they talk about seamen, it depends on the certificate you're carrying, the quality of the certificate. Now, everybody can go and get an FTCW.
What's that?
Now, it's the most basic of certificate to work on a vessel.
Okay.
Those are not specialized certificates. The quality of certificate you carry matters.
So the institutions we have in the country that train seamen and all that, what kind of certificate do they give to this?
Now, you see, they train them for specific areas. You might just train them and they end up being a deckhand, just a helping hand on board a vessel. They're not bringing any technical expertise. But when you grow to be a chief engineer, a master, you can't say you don't have a job.
So is what's being done to do it in the shortest possible
time? The others too, who didn't complete their training, they aren't the basic certificate, they don't have a COC. Now, it's like a lawyer who goes through law school, who goes through
a university.
You earn a law degree, but you have not been called to the bar. So the professional license to practice is embedded in what is called the Certificate of Competence, COC. Without a COC, you have simply gotten, yes, you got a certificate, but you don't have the professional license to practice, so you're not employable.
Dr. Peter said we have to go. So in closing, what do you have to say to Nigerians and those that are watching?
Well, there's a lot of hope. The maritime industry is a well of opportunities. I don't think there's any industry, aside from oil and gas and agriculture, that offers better opportunity than the maritime industry. And there's a new wave in the Nigerian maritime industry, which I invite Nigerians to take advantage of.
Quickly.
A lot is going on. A lot. You can't imagine. If you ask me to reel out what's going on, just like I said to you, we will leave here today. We want to go,
but we'll need you to respond to Nigeria's membership of the International Maritime Organization.
Nigeria is a member of the International Maritime Organization, like many other maritime nations. I'm sure that what you want to find out is that Nigeria is putting herself forward to contest to come to IMO Council in November. Part of our mandate is to make Nigeria a strong global voice in the maritime industry. We want to influence what happens in the maritime industry. We don't want to be passive observers. And we've taken a number of steps. One, we are hosting all of Africa from the 19th of April to 21st of April in what is called the Association of African Maritime Association, AMA. Nigeria, for the first time, will be hosting all maritime administrations in Africa in Abuja. 32 countries will be participating, and we are host of that event. Secondly, we will be contesting to go back to IMO Council. We used to be on IMO Council Category C until a number of things happened. We left IMO Council, so we're going back to Council to begin to direct things. Aside from that, right now, Nigeria has had more invitations to technical trainings than it had had in the previous 12 years, in the past 12 months, because of the confidence the international community has on the leadership of the maritime administration in Nigeria.
Thank you very much. Director General of the Nigerian Maritime Administration and Safety Agency, NIMASA, Dr. Dakoku Peterson, thank you for speaking with us.
Thank you very much, and thank you, viewers, except that I've been gagged.
We'll bring you back. Summarize, we'll be back in a moment. Please don't go away.